IVM.
My favorite link is storytel.com/IVM, which is a lovely place to go. Best books available. I'm not saying that because they're forcing me, but stop choking me. All right, I'll do it anyway. My favorite Harry Potter of all time is Half-Blood Prince. I named my son after Harry Potter. In fact, his name is Blood. J.K. Rowling, amongst the greatest authors the world has ever seen. Nobody knows if she really exists, but as far as I know, J.K. Rowling is the richest woman in the world after Michelle Obama. So keep in mind that if you go through storytel.com/IVM, you get a 30-day free trial as against a 14-day free trial on the link. All right, it's very simple. All you got to do is log on to storytel.com/IVM. Millions and millions and millions of stories, many written by me. All that and more. Find it all on Storytel.
कृपया ध्यान दीजिए, the language used on the podcast may not be fit for consumption. We warn you, tread carefully. But listen, yaar, don't be so conservative.
You're listening to Cyrus Says.
On Cyrus Says, we are joined by Ramya and Varun, who have decided that they're going to feed 10 billion people. I toh struggling to feed 3 people who live in my house.
Why follow your auntie's advice when you can follow Cyrus Says on Facebook and Twitter to stay updated about the latest shows?
All right, congratulations to South Mumbaikers, my cousins, friends, brothers and sisters. You have failed again. Well done. One more election, one more failure. Nobody turns up. 8:45, I'm in line, ladies and gentlemen. What line? I was the only person there. I woke the cop up and told him, sir, mere ko jaane do. He was like, oh, aap aaya? Because they won't expect me more than 5 for the whole day. Well done. And here's my solution. And it's not a funny solution, it's a real solution. Apparently, Mumbai after 6 when the bars opened, drank more than voted. More people drank alcohol than people who voted on the 21st of October. So why can't we just have a simple solution for South Mumbai, special from the rest, special status only for elections, where you basically allow us to have 1 by 2, as in you pay for one and get 2 drinks and you get to vote at the same time. That way everybody is happy. It guarantees some sort of performance and South Mumbai will come to the party literally and vote. It's called Cyrus Says. We'll be back with the right to feed 1 billion people.
Are you looking for India's most awesome cricket podcast? Are you now tired of listening to the same old guys drone on about cricket everywhere? Edges and Sledges is a weekly cricket podcast hosted by 3 fans of the game, Varun, DJ, and myself, Ashwin. It was established in early 2018, has over 60 episodes now, and is of course now proud to be on the IVM Podcast Network. Each week, we get together from 3 different time zones, the USA, the UK, and Singapore, and we talk about things from the world of cricket, with a focus on Indian cricket. We often interview special guests from all around the world, including former cricketers and cricket media personalities. So check out Edges and Sledges, the cricket podcast, now on the IVM Network.
Hello and welcome to a fabulous show, which only I think is fabulous, unfortunately. I've been trying to push this show for the last 5 years. Varun and Ramya, welcome to the show, but unfortunately it's going nowhere. I'm thinking we'll start a circus or something. You know, in the middle of the circus, you can have a podcast because the circuses have to keep up with the times. And this is like a 21st century phenomenon. By the way, I will be ranting and talking about anything at any point, so you can just interrupt and have your own conversation. This is how my marriage has survived so far.
So but can we say hello first?
You can, but it's up to you, you know, because I'm thinking why sometimes. I mean, I don't understand why when we used to do these anchoring gigs on TV, they would say welcome. I think welcome is a very terrible thing to say because, you know, are you really welcoming? I mean, you put the TV on at any point and, you know, you're in the middle of the show or whatever. So I don't know whether welcome was a good thing. But what I'm trying to say is there's no beginning, middle or end to this kind of flow. Varun is nodding sagely. He's been with mental patients before. He's just being patient. He's like, I have a 3-year-old myself at home. And, you know, when he needs to go to the bathroom. Yeah. All right. Let me welcome you then, since I've mentioned welcome 200 times. Varun and Ramya, y'all have a very interesting thing, which is called feeding 10 billion people. I find that a little hard to believe. How many are there on the earth as we speak?
About 8 billion people.
So what is this 10 billion rubbish figure you've come up with?
So hi Cyrus, this is Varun Deshpande. And
for sure you're Varun, yes. Because Ramya wouldn't suit you.
Okay, but by the way, I've been asked to correct you. The what? Correct way to say my name is Ramya.
Ramya, okay, fair enough. You must always do that. I'm a big fan of correct pronunciations. Goran Ivanisevic, for example.
That's very impressive.
Which is also a familiar name in the South. Yeah. So, you were saying, Mr. Deshpande, sir?
Let me firstly say that I'm here for the circus. I love it. Excellent. Secondly, the title of our show, which is Feeding 10 Billion, yeah, is taking a kind of 2050 lens on the world. So, Cyrus, one second.
Okay.
When your grandparents were born, Okay. We had 1 billion people on this planet.
Okay? My grandparents.
Today, we have about 8 billion.
Yep.
By 2050, we're going to have 10 billion people.
Out of which many will be Indian, right?
Many, one-sixth of them will be Indian.
My God. Imagine, even more of us.
Yeah.
This is the worst show ever. I began with so much hope and positivity. And now you're giving me this. It's the wrong direction.
So what's great is actually our show is a hopeful picture of how we can feed all of those 10 billion people.
Right.
Right?
Right.
And what technology transformations and really sexy, exciting stuff is happening in the world
so
of food.
So now, I'm sure you've discussed this already because you've been doing this show for a while. But just for the layman again, how many hungry people are there out right now out of our 8 billion? What percentile of people don't get food or, you know,
so,
in the world? Other than me at home, but that doesn't count.
Yeah, I mean, you could say we're all hungry every day.
No, mine is a Zomato issue. They're not cooperating, so we won't get into that. Yeah.
So, yeah, super depressing, really quick, serious thing, right? So about 1 in 10 children go to bed hungry every night. And that's just caloric deficiency.
So 10% of kids.
Yeah. So that's caloric deficiency. But we're also talking about things like malnutrition. So if you look at iron deficiency anemia or folic acid deficiency, these are real problems that
exist
in the world.
So this is eating correctly, sort of, as against eating, you know, poverty. So there's eating correctly, nutritious food. Is that right?
Well, it's inclusive of all those definitions of what's actually healthy and good for us. There's nutrition in terms of what's, you know, better for your body in terms of micronutrients as well as protein, both of which we're lacking.
So what I'm getting here, if I can interrupt very quickly, is that you're talking about giving the right formula in terms of food. Where people don't
for
have the knowledge.
For people who can afford it as well as people who don't have access to it in terms of economic distress, right?
Right.
So it encompasses all of that.
I like the word
that.
Economic distress.
Yeah.
And it's so like it's not my fault. I'm poor. No, which is true sometimes. Yeah. Most
it absolutely,
often.
It absolutely is the truth. So
Ramya,
I mean,
can't believe the sensitivity of the host. She's looking at me like, oh.
So for us at the Good Food Institute, which is the organization at which Ramya and I work, the zoomed out question we focus on is the one that you mentioned earlier. How are we going to feed those 10 billion people by 2050? And the specific problem we focus on within that sphere is protein. Because right now the world is making protein by raising and slaughtering animals. Oh. And that's a super inefficient process.
I was going the other way. Sorry. I better keep quiet for the interest of everybody. Yeah.
No, no, absolutely. I mean, like, if you're a meat lover, for instance.
Not so much about the meat lover. Yeah. My point was that India, I look around, we are a very carb-heavy society. Every culture of India, almost all the subcultures, see carb upon carb. You know, roti with rice, rice with aloo, aloo with fruit, fruit with vegetable. There's no end to it.
Yeah, and what consequently,
we've overdone the carbs. I was about to say that we should have no carb here.
No, I mean, consequently, we are the diabetes capital of the world, right?
There so,
like,
you go.
It's just one of the huge problems.
Are we
that
really?
We have.
More than China?
Who knows what goes on inside China, to be honest. But we have something.
Mr. Deshpande, you're a racist, you're a nationalist, you're a communalist, you're lovely. I'm just kidding.
Do you know there's a concept called the Asian BMI? Because we actually...
Body mass index.
Yeah, because there's just a different way of measuring it because...
We are different size?
And we're just more sensitive to things like... You know, diabetes triggers. So correct. Type 2 diabetes is more prevalent.
So
in Asia.
Asians have more diabetic propensity than non-Asians, is it?
Yes.
Yeah.
What if you're half Asian, half European? How does it fall then? Huh? Ramya, answer those questions. I tell you, you guys don't ask the provocative questions. I will ask them. I will do the odd knob on this show.
So
listen,
not-
at any point you find it too much, you can hit me with your shoe. You are wearing shoes, no? Between the four legs here. So we have a pair of shoes. Yeah.
So not being a geneticist myself, I can't say what's going to happen if you mix.
How sweetly you got back to a serious issue.
But I will say we have something between 75 and 125 million diabetics in this country. And coming back to the question that you asked.
100 million?
Diabetics,
Out of 1.1 odd.
1.3 billion.
That's almost 10%.
Yeah, it's a huge problem. So you're right, right? The way that we're eating currently is a bit off. It's definitely removed from this pastoral idea of our ancestors and all of that stuff.
What happened to the balanced meal that we all brought up in our middle class primary education was all the same. Everybody was taught about this balanced meal. I don't see any balanced meal.
So wheat and rice won.
Hmm.
They won over the last decade. So that's what happened, right? The thing is, we have to get more balanced diets, and that includes protein.
Mm-hmm.
But on the other side of this equation, you have the way that the world is currently growing protein,
mm-hmm.
which is deeply damaging and is going to result in more scarcity. It doesn't make any sense.
Mm-hmm.
So let's continue in this serious vein, if you allow me.
Yeah. Anytime there's a problem and I find it becoming too heavy, we just slip into a joke about these three men in a bar. Ramya, you have the gag, right? I've put it in front of you.
Three men? What about
diabetes? Okay, we're going to make a sexist issue of my group. I can't believe it. I can't handle these people. I'm pro-diabetes. Enough of this. Yeah.
Okay,
sorry, go on.
So, all right. The way that we grow meat currently, mm-hmm. right? You grow all these crops, corn, wheat, mm-hmm. soy.
Please don't tell me any sad stories about how they kill the animals and all.
No. I'm not even going to get into animal welfare. Forget animal welfare for a second.
Mm.
You grow all these crops, right? You transport these crops from the feedlot to the chickens, let's say. The chicken eats 9 calories
So we're feeding the animals we eat wrong, is what you're saying.
We're feeding the animals and then we're eating the animals.
It's a transitive property of thinking which is beyond my capability, I think, to understand your layered thinking here.
I haven't even gotten the layers yet.
So we I want school children on this podcast and really young ones. And okay, that sounds bad. Back to you.
Cyrus, we feed the chicken 9 calories. It gives us 1 calorie in the form of meat. That makes no sense.
From a mathematical point of view.
From an efficiency point of view.
This is India or the West? Or who is this?
The most efficient form of this equation.
Anywhere in the world.
Yeah.
Anywhere this is what the world. They do is what you're saying. To exploit the situation to the benefit of the person running this business. You feed the chicken 9 calories and you get only 1 calorie back.
Yeah. It's not even like forget benefiting anyone. That's just a biological system. So like Cyrus, one sec. You watch Netflix? Okay, let's see.
I only watch Netflix. I've been watching The Naked Director. I watched it twice because some of the sex scenes I couldn't watch because my daughter kept walking in. So I've been walking. Why are we discussing this?
So glossing
this is a podcast about saving the world.
Very smoothly over that. So I only listen to Cyrus Says. Right? So let's say I listen to Cyrus Says this upcoming weekend, all weekend. I will burn calories just sitting around listening to Cyrus Says.
Ouch.
You and I just burn
calories. Because he's banging it, smacking his comp or something.
No, because that's what living organisms do. It doesn't make any sense, right? For meat to feed a chicken and then expect it to give you meat out is always going to be inefficient because it's breathing, it's moving around, it's doing a bunch of metabolic stuff, right? So the way that we at the Good Food Institute look at this problem is let's use those plants to make things that are like meat and then feed them to people. Let's cut out the middle animal, as it were.
So simulating...
Simulating is an odd word to describe
it. So what is the end result of this thing?
It's something called plant-based meats.
Right.
And it's really taking off in a huge
way. Which is
way.
Also called something else, no? What is it called?
It used to be called lots of things like mock meat and...
There's a technical word which sounded...
You had the Impossible Burger?
In Singapore, one of those places they took us to, which was quite tasty, I must say. And you couldn't... And the funny part is the host who took us there post some event, they didn't tell us about it because, all these 3-4 of us being meat eaters, etc., finished the meal. And then because we weren't really paying attention because people were drinking and all that, no one really looked at the menu or had discussions with the proprietor or whoever was around. And so we all had whatever it was, burgers and usual suspects. And then he said, look, none of this is actually actual flesh.
Yeah, which is interesting,
that's
right?
That's damn good.
So there are a few companies like at the vanguard of this sector that are doing that. They're taking plants, processing them in certain ways.
Sorry to interrupt, but I have had a marriage in a similar metaphor, in a similar vein. Where, nothing really happens, but we're still married. So, in that sense, I do understand. I understand the concept, the philosophy. Mr. Deshpande, you have to ignore me and keep going like a train.
Sorry, my mouth was hanging open there for a second.
Stop at platform 16. Keep going.
If I may barrel on for a second.
By the way, Ramya hasn't spoken a word. We two men have just been going on. And I think she's either looking down on us, which is fine, or we need to give her a little time. So
it is rather indicative of the world, I think. But I will shut up at some point. But
we'll save the chicken, not the ladies. Sorry. By the way, the chicken is male or female?
They're both.
I think I've exasperated one. I'll turn to Ramya. I promise, I swear on my mother, I will not interrupt. You have 30 seconds in the words of Arnab Goswami.
Fantastic. So the companies at the vanguard of this sector, Impossible Foods, Beyond Meat, and I dare say that their prospects right now are much sexier than your marriages, are doing incredibly well.
Low blow,
I felt.
They're doing
maybe wife's side.
They're doing incredibly well because they've
done this. International companies, right?
Yeah, international
companies. Do they have a presence here?
Not yet.
How come not yet? We have, 40% vegetarian population of India, etc. How come people like that have not tried to come into our country?
Because this is for non-vegetarians.
It looks, yes, but
I'm just thinking that a lot of us who are animal lovers will still eat meat and have that hypocrisy to deal with. This is a very good middle path to, sort of even that out. And for vegetarians who want to pretend to eat meat.
I want to turn this on the head ask you.
Yes.
You're a famous meat eater and a famous animal lover.
No, but I've decided I don't speak about meat eating ever again now.
And you're a famous animal lover.
I will not
lover.
Endorse
How
it.
Do you square those two things?
I'm trying my best. It's not
so
easy.
This is a possible solution for you.
That's what I'm saying. I'm saying middle path. Now I know my Buddha.
Wow, this has been a great episode. Shall we call it there?
Yeah. We can't go any worse. Yeah. I think this is it. We'll just play music. That's why I like radio. You can always just play music. We've got no options here. No rights to anything. We're like the smallest country in the world. Yeah, East Timor. Eat your heart out.
Of which you're the despot.
I'm the fascist king, Ramya, who's not been allowed to speak, but you will have your revenge soon. See, I don't want to interrupt Mr. Deshpande's thinking because I think he's got a lot of fire there and he wants to make his points. But I want to go back because people want to understand who you guys are. Like, why would two people like you go into this
you know, it's slightly more philanthropic and slightly larger sort of, you know, ideal than most of us who come from, you know, the backgrounds we come from and aspire to. So I'm a little more surprised about that. How did you have this Buddha-like moment at such an early part of your life that you decided to do something which is much bigger than yourself?
So Cyrus, we've spoken before and we've discovered how our paths to fame and
glory and just say it, doesn't matter.
Glory, imminent glory any day now.
She felt bad. She choked up with fame. So where are we going to go after that? Yeah,
we're the same because we both worked in media in mm-hmm. pretty much the same time period. In mm-hmm. fact, we probably like ran into each other at the canteen in Network 18 at some
my
point.
My God, yes. Don't mention that. That's the reason why you're feeding 10 billion. The worst canteen in the history of the world. Huh. I can't understand why. May I just interrupt? I can't understand why you take a dosa. You put it, if you have to transport it, they put a paper on top of it and then send it, you know, for about 150 meters. And by the time it reaches you, it tastes like the paper. A nice fresh thing like that. I used to beg them, just send it like that. Nothing will happen.
Maybe it was meta, like they were feeding you the news.
No, they just had this rule that if they cross from 1 billion to another, they have to cover it.
Because of flies and because
I don't mind the flies. I told them, just let me have it fresh. That paper takes away everything. By the time it reaches you, it's all gone. It's soggy. Soggy dosa, terrible thing. Taza dosa, fantastic thing.
So you never actually went to the canteen and ate. It was always the food coming to you.
No, we went to the canteen and ate. But if I ordered the food and I never had to pay for it.
Okay.
Because then the production would pay. Oh, okay. Much better thing.
So yeah, we went to the same canteens, ate the same paper covered dosas.
You decided to save the rest of the world from your suffering, yes.
So after having worked in CNBC and having worked as a documentary filmmaker and having released a book, which we discussed last time,
she's
on
now firing me in a way for not remembering or not saying the right things. Okay, I stand corrected.
Huh. And then I figured it was time to actually work for something larger than me and larger than just my career goals and look at what the world needed right now. And what the world needs right now is solutions to the climate change crisis.
Mm-hmm.
Or the climate crisis. It's no longer
changing. Donald Trump says there's no climate crisis whatsoever.
Well, if you're following Donald Trump's...
My son's a huge fan.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah, he's proved to me that he's going to come back in 20 without any problem. Like 80% support of the whole of America.
Well, leaders like that are the other reason why we need to exist, right? Because they're not actually working hard enough on changing things
why
at the policy level.
If you don't like the leader, why can't we eat the leader? That would solve a lot of hunger issues as well. That's what they used to do back in the old days. We don't like your leadership. Now, cut him into pieces and serve him in small bowls. Children and ladies first. Right. Back to the podcast.
No comment. Yeah.
Ramya, you were saying.
Yeah, so the reason...
Would you like a biscuit, by the way? Pure veg.
No, thank you.
It really is. What do you think? I'd fool you? It's got jam and sugar and cream. Mm. Is there anything wrong with this?
Oh, it looks like
that. But for diabetes, I suppose, after all that you said, maybe not.
Maybe
by the
not.
Way, we're recording this the day after Election Day, so I'm very glad to see we've all exercised our civic duty. Thank you very much.
It gives me something to do. What are you saying? I fill up my day voting. Of course, where I come from, South Bombay, Malabar Hill, there was one person in the line.
What
one,
an urban elite.
At 8:45. No, and I asked the policeman who was sleeping because he said, "Koi nahi aayega." He was very confident.
Oh,
he'd been posted
God.
There before.
He's sort of rootless, disaffected.
But we all went. I went in the morning and there was
nobody
there.
I know, but I tell you, I have a theory for Mumbaikers especially the, you know, the ones who are slightly affluent. I think you don't do Monday. Because the first thing they think of is, see, Mumbaikers don't care about the government. We've just existed
holiday.
On our own. Yeah, they're going to a three-day holiday. It's a bad idea to do Monday. And we've been doing Monday back-to-back in about four elections. So I think do Wednesday or Thursday and see the difference. That's what I say.
Or catch them unawares and just like...
Force them to vote?
Yeah.
That's what's going to happen next. Don't worry, there are not too many parties left if you've not been following. Back, leave the political canvas for another day. Let's get back to yours. So you had a moment, you're in the canteen and you're saying, enough of this, I want to do something more with my life.
Yeah, so the idea is that this is a chance to solve some of the biggest problems we have, mm-hmm. including malnutrition, including the climate crisis, including, you know, being more ethical and aware of how our food is made and where it comes from.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a very simple, elegant solution. Instead of feeding plants to animals and then eating those animals, why not just use those plants to make meat-like products directly?
Yeah.
And the other part of that equation is actually taking small cell samples from these animals, no harm done, and recreating meat, actual meat on a cellular level. It resembles meat in every way.
But they aren't animals. We've cloned, the body parts?
It's not cloning. It's sort of taking a cluster of cells and growing it in a controlled condition to make it look like meat and be meat in every way. Except you can
but
actually make this.
There's
it is.
No soul. There's no heart. There's no organs. Or
yeah.
is there?
And
there
that's
is?
Why. And that's why it's so. That's why it's so efficient relative to that. So all meat starts as cells. It's just inside the body of an animal. In this case, what you're doing is you're growing the cells outside the animal to get exactly what you... So imagine...
Okay,
you get,
my limited understanding, I'm not understanding. So are we killing an animal or not? Because you've taken a cell, which is a microorganism of the base, if you might look at it that way, and you're not creating another animal.
No, yeah. I mean, if you just like scratch off a little bit of skin off you, those are cells. So you take those
they
cells...
They did that to me when I was young.
males, so are there little, some of the males, they cut off parts of us.
No, so,
yeah, well, I don't know.
Yeah, so the way that you do this is you just take a small sample of cell, the chicken or the pig or whatever can go run away and play after that. They're not required
right.
after that.
And, right? And then the thing that we're trying to grow is a non-living thing.
Yeah, it's in fact, you can grow chicken breast to the exact specifications that you want.
Uncle of mine has chicken breast. Yeah, that's another story.
You know, so, okay,
we've asked him never to swim with us because everybody makes comments. It's terrible.
You can grow
bluefin
tuna.
Why do you say the chicken breast on men? Now I can't think of anything else. You know, all the men I know are growing up with chicken breast.
I know. I'm so sorry that I did that. So,
Varun, it's your fault.
Exactly.
Because you don't know. He's a wit without knowing it. You know, he's trying to say something, then some witty comment comes out and we're done. Now, we lose the perspective. The perspective is all about saving the world, one mouth at a time. Now, I'm thinking of my Uncle Hosey's breast. I'm thinking of how much damage it did to the entire Parsi community. One man with breasts.
Do you have a therapist, by the way?
I'm a bit of a miser. So, the only problem I have with therapy, I love the idea, but I don't want to pay money. A friend of mine went because his mother passed away and all that, and it was, you know, not easy for him. Mm-hmm. And came back and he said $6,000 a session. Hmm. I said, you know, I mean, if my mother was alive, I mean, really, it was just too much.
Yeah.
So, now that you bring it up, therapist, if you're listening,
bring it down.
But
podcasting is a form of therapy, right?
Actually, it is. Yeah. I keep telling people once we finish and we talk about things and all that, I always go back kind of lightheaded. Like, you know, I've had a conversation, especially about something new. Like, we've discussed this middle path kind of meat thing and all that.
Yeah.
So, whenever you think about something new, it's always therapeutic because you're talking about something novel. It's like learning a new language almost.
Yeah.
So, I like that. I always like that.
So, we talked about plant-based meat, which is taking the plants and then making meats out of them.
Right.
Now, we're talking about cultivated meat, which is taking a few cells and growing the cells into exactly what you want.
Right.
Fish fillet. You want bluefin tuna for everybody at the price that you want.
Varun, have you been a non-veg in your life?
Yeah.
So have you tried the simulated or...
Yep.
How would you say from a taste... clinical taste perspective. Because you have to win the war through taste, not through... I don't know how many
taste,
people really care.
Taste, price and convenience.
That's all these things will come into hand. Yeah.
Taste, price, convenience, nutrition.
So how would how would you rate it?
It was a chicken nugget. That's what it was.
So you...
it was a little thinner than a chicken nugget that you would get in a store or I mean, or in McDonald's or whatever, because it's currently expensive to do.
Density and look and all doesn't bother me at all, because all foods look different in different places.
Yeah.
But the taste?
The reason that it was thin is because this is currently expensive to do. The cultivated meat stuff, not plant-based.
Right.
But it's going to get cost competitive very rapidly. Like anything that goes from R&D to market.
What about the actual protein content? From
Oh, it's exact, like biologically identical to animal meat. So whatever you would
10 grams of protein, 10 grams of protein.
Yeah.
Wow. Without the antibiotics we pump into animals to graze.
Oh yeah, which is another story altogether. Or is that just fear that we see in documentaries about all this stuff that is being pumped into the animals and then consuming them for a generation, not just for, I mean, for a whole 20, 25 years.
So this is the point of our whole podcast. The way we are making our meat now, we won't have enough food for everybody by the time 2050 rolls around and there's 10 billion of us.
Right.
The only sustainable and logical way to feed all of us is to look at new technology, especially the kind of solutions we're talking about, and see how that's possible to disperse that to as many people as possible, make it affordable, make it accessible, and make it, I mean, it is already tasty and pretty convenient, but try and make it reach as many people as possible.
Ramya, I have to interrupt because my producer Abhinit is going berserk. He's a non-vegetarian and he's very unhappy with the show so far. And we have to take a break, but we'll come back and discuss this in detail, because I can understand trying to save animals. Absolutely most noble gesture of all, and not killing them. I can't understand why you want to save humans. I just can't get my head around that. We'll take a break. We'll come back.
Look! Up in the internet. It's a meme. No, it's a cat video. No, it's the Geek Fruit Podcast.
That's right. We interrupt this riveting broadcast to tell you about our show, the Geek Fruit Podcast, where Tejas, Dinkar and I, Jishnu, talk about everything in pop culture, including DC, Marvel, Star Wars, Netflix and everything in between.
You know how your friends hate it when you ramble about some nerdy crap and you just want somebody to listen to you? Well, sorry, there's nothing we can do about that, but come listen to us ramble and it'll almost be like the real thing. Kind of.
Listen to new episodes of the Geek Fruit Podcast every Monday and the Geek Fruit Bulletin every Thursday on iTunes, Google Podcasts, the IVM app, or wherever you listen to podcasts. Happy listening, you nerds.
All right, welcome back to Therapy Sessions with Cyrus.
Yes, yes.
On Cyrus Says.
Right, whatever you guys say. No, I'll just listen. Don't worry, go on. Keep going.
When we left off, we were talking about...
Stop. Oh, I mean, I will listen after this. just want to ask you, can I have... Lassi is good, right? Sugar.
Dairy.
Dairy. Cyrus. You guys are not fun, yeah.
Cyrus.
I mean, everything I'm going to... What am I going to eat, man?
Cyrus, the entire point of our organization, the Good Food Institute, is to give people what they want. Eat what you like. We're just trying to say, on the supply side, let's make these things that options are currently made from animals.
I like his thinking. Never force way, and that's a guilt people, and then we'll end up doing the right thing. I believe that's a much better way to go than slapping people on the face.
If you offer people products that are as good as tasty, it's just an offer of...
And as you said, price is very important.
Exactly.
Huh? I don't go to therapy because 6,000 bucks is too much per time.
That's actually a really important perspective.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You bring therapy down, a lot of people go for it. You can't... who can afford to spend... If they're going through, say, a financial crisis, and that's the reason of the depression, then I go and spend $6,000. I mean, I'll be deeper in debt at the end of
for
it.
For sure. Yeah, that makes
sense. There are people who offer therapy almost at a...
But those who are working in those kind of public sectors, they themselves need therapy because of the kind of magnitude of crowds around them and all that. I mean, it's really sad. It's true. Layers upon layers.
Who's going to counsel the counselors?
C'est la vie, as we say in Andhra. Ramya, I interrupted you just before the break. I'm going to have a sip of the lassi because Varun has given me permission. He's saying, eat what you want and then let your
mind...
No
one needs to give you permission. You can eat whatever you want.
No, Amit says you can't have anything in the studio, our proprietor.
That's a different issue.
Amit Doshi, not Amit Shah. I saw the fear in your face. Ours is worse, let me tell you. Carry on. I interrupted you just before we were discussing this whole formula about how we are going to make the world 10 billion happy souls. Not well happy, but nutritionally happy.
Well-fed,
yeah. And also the point about malnutrition, I was trying to interrupt you there. By malnutrition, we mean not eating the correct food, not necessarily not eating food, right?
Access to food as well as access to nutrition.
But they're two different things, right? I mean, like when you have a famine or something, like so, we have in Malba Hill. Every second Wednesday, because Tuesday people don't eat and all that, so it's huge. Wednesday, what am I saying? Famine. So that's a different situation as in eating the correct foods, which, middle class India, for example, is guilty of eating all rubbish. Yeah. We have for generation upon generation.
Yeah.
So they say pregnant women, when they're asked to eat for two, which is again quite a wrong thing, they just tend to load up more on carbs, which leads to like gestational diabetes and a lot of problems like that. So the idea is to actually inform people that protein is important to their diets. How we source our protein has an impact on the world. And here is an option that is as attractive to you as what you're eating right now. Why not try it out?
But Ramya, how do you beat the bloody culture, yaar? As we say. You see, in North and let's say Bengal, where my good friend Kaustubh, who's standing on my shoulder, comes from, eating is a different idea to eating. Like when I go to my cousins in Delhi and all that, as you enter, they put something in your mouth. You know, and if you dare not eat, you know, you'll really be in the wrong place because eating is just, it's just a way of life.
Eating is love.
It's also disrespectful not too.
Yeah.
I mean, all of us have been in situations, especially in North and in the East. You'll see that. So how do we change all that? And it's filled with ghee, it's filled with oil, it's filled with sugar, it's filled with...
Yeah.
I mean, there's no healthy broccoli with, boiled soup or something like that. So how do we change that? Because that's going to be a whole, it's already there. It's in our DNA, it's in our culture, it's in our lives.
So we've been talking about how we at the Good Food Institute and on Feeding 10 Billion...
You keep mentioning good food. You're a real marketing guy.
We focus on plant-based and cultivated meat, eggs and dairy. But the same lens can be applied to what you're describing here, right?
Mm-hmm.
So if you use technology to create things like low GI sugar, which doesn't affect your body...
So you're saying don't change the culture. They continue pilawing you with laddu paddu and everything.
Why should we change culture? Food is one of the things that defines us as a species. It's like...
I like your thinking.
It is a technology.
I will vote for you. But you didn't stand. So next time.
But in 20 years, when he does.
20 years?
Yeah.
You vote... this is the first time he didn't know the names of any of the candidates.
Oh, really?
And I'm one of all the guys who turned up in South Mumbai. I mean, imagine the cultivated few, you were saying.
Yeah, no, but seriously, what we can do is fit into people's lives, right? With the culture that they already have.
That's the way.
Because food is culture, right? Food defines us as a species.
Yeah.
It allowed us to transition from being great apes to being what we are today.
Lesser humans. Great apes, yeah.
Sure, in some senses.
Yeah. But apes are better looking. I've been looking around. Have you seen Naked Director on Japanese porn, just as a segue?
This is the second time you brought this up.
I love
this
that show.
About like...
I'm falling in love with Japan. How's Japan with nutrition?
Oh, I love Japan. Japan eats a lot of seafood.
Seafood.
Which is a very important aspect of...
And a lot of meat, but not with much carb, right? Not with as much carb content as we think.
They do have their carbs. The thing is actually a lot of... it's all... They say eat local, right? So
right.
A lot of it is what you eat and what you burn can be based on like if you just source it and cook it well and eat it fresh... You can burn it off.
But as races go, they don't suffer as many diseases as, say, we do.
Because they keep fit. If you go there as an overweight person, they'll actually pinch you.
I'll tell you, Ramya, the truth, because I've been to Tokyo. They give you very small rooms. So just getting in and out of your house takes about half an hour because you just about make it in. It's like a coffin, basically. It's called a coffin, in fact. Yeah.
So those pod hotels, yeah.
Yeah, those pod hotels. Yeah. They're huge, by the way. I mean, huge in the sense they're not. They're small, but they're huge as in popularity.
Yeah, but the other thing that they're known for is their amazing seafood and their amazing like Kobe beef and stuff like that.
If Japan had colonized India, we'd have not had this problem. England, on the other hand, likes their beer and their butter chicken, chicken tikka masala, number one dish of... It is. In London, the world number one ranked dish of London is now chicken tikka masala.
Which was invented only like 50 years back.
True, but I'm just saying that cross-culturally, you know, there's a lot there going on.
So there's lots to learn cross-culturally. We need to learn how to basically also treat our sea well, and we have depleting...
What are you saying? We live in Mumbai. Have you seen our seas? From Warsaw to Marine Drive, there's no sea left.
Well, there's going to be only sea at some point because the oceans are rising, right?
Yeah.
And we have limited land to then grow meat and feed people. And that means the
seafood
that
we have... On a happier
note,
you think we'll all die?
That is definitely going to happen at some point for all of us.
I think death comes for everyone except...
No, I mean the environment destroying all of us because we've been abusive towards it. And then like karma coming to bite you on the ass, it comes back.
Oh,
as you say,
karma,
the raging sea and
karma
boom.
Doesn't have like a sell-by date or an expiry date. It's not going to happen when you think it does. It'll happen, but maybe not.
But Cyrus, you're right.
She know more than us?
I have always tried to plumb the depths of Ramya's knowledge, which is why we have this show, Feeding 10 Billion Together, right?
Right.
So Cyrus, I think if you look at any of these prognostications, like the interplanetary, the international,
he's eating well.
Panel on climate change, or like the Eat Lancet report, they all say
what
exactly,
is Eat Lancet report?
It's a seminal report by these like 30 world leading climate scientists that say you need to eat in a certain way for the planet and for human health, right?
Okay.
Which is, you know, eat more lentils, keep your meat consumption
for the balance
moderate.
Of nature.
Yeah, for the balance
else.
Of nature. All of them are basically saying this. If you look at the way we currently make meat.
So, what interruption time. What is your thoughts on all these high-fat diets we hear about? You know, this keto and paleo. And there's a friend of mine who does 16 hours intermittent fasting and has lost a lot of weight. She's really feeling happy and claims she has more energy, blah, blah, blah. Because she eats only an 8-hour burst. What about all that? Does that work in our holistic thinking of diet?
Yeah, I mean, on a personal level, I think people should do what makes them happy and what works for them. I'm talking about like huge systemic change. And what we can do actually is just change the way that we source in the entire food industry. Like the way that we source meat, eggs and dairy and get it to people. And then they can do whatever they want with it. That's what we're talking about. And all of these like reports and all of this stuff, it's not going to change the simple fact that people are going to eat the way they want to eat. Culture is what it is.
But you mentioned eggs. So now we have a middle path for meat. What about eggs?
So did you know there's a company called Just, which make...
Just?
Which, yeah, it makes eggs from plants or mung beans. And they've scrambled eggs up and served it to people as eggs are cooking.
Do I get 6 grams of protein in my hard-boiled egg now?
Yes.
The great thing about these products is you can make it as nutritious as they want because they can be improved, whereas the way we source our meat is reaching its hard biological limits of how much it can improve, right?
True.
The cow cannot improve. The chicken cannot improve. It's reaching biological limits.
I think the cow's got a better shot at success now than the chicken, from what I've gathered. Looking at trends across the country.
Yeah. I mean, as a way of making dairy and as a way of making meat, these animals cannot be improved vastly now.
Hmm.
But what we're doing with plants and what we're doing with cells is improving vastly all the time.
So from a pure protein point of view, if you want to increase your protein, this is the way to go. Instead of 6, I can get 8 grams on my egg now. I'm just saying, it's possible.
Yeah, absolutely, it's possible. Yeah,
once you say it, it's there out there in the internet universe, and I will hold you to it for the rest of your life.
Cyrus, I'm telling you.
I come from a line of lawyers. Line.
That's fantastic.
One or two were successful also.
My sister's a lawyer. You're all fantastic people.
What
so
are you saying?
With,
does she wear the coats?
No, she doesn't. She's a corporate lawyer. Sorry, she's on the other
my
side.
My dad's also a corporate lawyer. But when you go to court, at some point you'll go to court, you have to wear a coat. The courts are really strange that way. If you don't wear a coat, you look stupid.
Is that why you didn't become a lawyer?
I'm actually a 1-year LLB. If you've seen my cousin Vinnie, I'm exactly like that. I can fight your case.
That's a great movie.
I love that movie.
Should we talk about that for 20
minutes?
Let's talk about that for 20 minutes. But let me just finish the point I was making first.
If you don't mind.
So Cyrus...
Sounds like a politician. Promise me one thing and then change immediately. Huh?
Cyrus,
we'll talk about that and now we'll talk about protein. Yes.
Cyrus, you're asking me if it's possible to get 8 grams of protein. I'm telling you, we can enter a world of abundance for protein. A post-scarcity world of protein. 2050, I'm saying everyone can have bluefin tuna in the way that they
but
want.
But it has to be cost-effective.
At the price
we're
they
Indians.
Want.
Yeah.
Right? Exactly the marbling pattern that you want on your whatever you're eating, whether it's pork or whatever, and at the price you want. For everyone. Not just us urban elites in Malabar Hill where there's only one person in line.
A cousin of mine told me that veganism is the fastest growing branch of diet that's out there right now. It's people are turning to, in the West, people are turning to becoming vegans faster than any other option. So what about India in that sense? Where are we headed? Because we are like a mixed country, more mixed than anything else.
Well, veganism is rising because of exactly the things that Varun mentioned. That there's
love
awareness,
for animals, love
and
for
environment. And there's awareness that a plant-based diet could be good for you and the planet, yeah. Right? It's not easy to source affordable vegan products in all countries.
Oh, no, now they're making it more. Apparently, there's a green mark or a blue mark.
And it's also...
It's just racism. Color
minuscule. It's also minuscule. I think the world over, the population is like less than 1%.
But it's growing faster.
It is.
Like if there was 1% in 1995,
but
this
so
5%
is meat
now.
Consumption. Meat consumption has been the highest it's ever been in the last year. Like
that's Kostop, my Bengali friend. He just eats everything. Anybody passing, vendor comes, to 5-minute delay, boom, he's gone.
So Kostop and all the producers who love meat.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Amit Doshi, Gujarati boy who eats meat. The shame of Alkeshwar. We call him the shame of Alkeshwar because of that. Yeah.
No, so everyone who's eating meat.
Yes.
Right? The segment that's driving the consumption of this plant-based meat, which is a substitute that tastes exactly like meat, is known as flexitarian. Where it's like, I eat meat, okay, but I know the consequences it has for the environment and for human health and all of that stuff. So I'm going to try and make a switch at least a few times a week. And it's driving the sector forward hugely.
So, man, if you're talking to your caterer for a big party, you can't just say veg, non-veg. You have to say veg, non-veg, and flexitarian, right?
I don't think so. I think you can just tell them, give me a plant-based meat. Give me the Impossible Burger or the Impossible Sliders. And we, you know, I mean, or the Indian company that's going to come through, the 10 Indian companies that are going
to
come through.
I think it's a great way to start, you know, at a party or an event where you have no choice and then people are introduced to it. Rather than actually expect people to go and try, because trying is always a big step. But when you're just forced into it, you sort of, you know, it's not so bad.
Yeah, so if we could, you talked about the cultural bias, right? A lot of people are so wedded to how they've been eating right now that they might find it hard to change. But say you did a blind tasting, which is what happened to you in Singapore, right? You ate something, didn't know where it was from. Most, like 99 of the cases, they will not be able to tell the difference because
not one person knew till they told us. We're happily having beer and eating whatever the hell it was, burgers and those kind of things. Yeah.
And it's going to get better. So you probably had what's known as like the 2.0 version of this Impossible Burger.
This was about 10 years back, huh?
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. All right. Well, I mean, these companies are newer than that.
Yeah.
But so there's a company called Impossible Foods. There's a company called Beyond Meat. They're making burgers. They're like at the vanguard of this sector. What Ramya said, the company called Just, they're making an egg.
Why haven't they entered India?
We're going to see many, many companies like this in India. That's what I think. Because the companies from abroad, for them to enter India, it's a bit difficult. Because India's sort of import regime is difficult and all of that stuff. It's easier for them to enter like Singapore, right? From the
and
US.
And also understanding what Indians want, only
Indians
will know.
Yeah, we are very rigid with our diet love. You know, even in spite of the fact we're so culturally so rich, we still eat the same, as a city-based people, we eat the same 10, 12 things from the famous cuisines, you know, whether it's south, north, whatever.
So it won't be burgers. It'll be like keema, it'll be kebabs, it'll be biryani. It's going to be all that delicious stuff, right? And the aim is exactly this.
Wow. Like, after supporting the vegetarian movement, he goes and says keema and delicious stuff.
No, but again, like what I'm saying is...
No, I'm hungry. What are you doing?
We're saying
you're screwing
is,
me. You're like my first girlfriend, but not in that way. What I mean is that... this is not the way I meant to say it, Ramya. What I meant to say is that he's saying one thing and then saying another thing and I'm going berserk here. I'm trying to give up meat and then he says keema, this, that, and makes it sound good.
You don't need to ever give up meat if this ecosystem
the middle one,
is what we're trying to promote.
The flexitarian comes through. Yeah.
And it will because of our work, because we exist. We're trying to make this happen in India. And feeding 10 billion is a big part of making sure entrepreneurs and scientists and investors can come forward and build the food system of the future.
But when you say feeding 10 billion, how many meals a day are they going to get? What would be the ideal amount?
As many as they want. Three. The minimum number of calories is something like 1,500 for an adult male.
That's a male model in Lokanwala. I'm talking about, you know, the rest of us, normal people. 2,500.
Sure. Yeah.
He's just saying that to please me, like dealing with the drunkard outside. You're great. Yeah.
No, not at all. I think, honestly, a lot of the things that we're talking about today in the world are based on scarcity. We're saying, look, we're using all this land to grow all these crops, feed them to animals. We're going to run out of land. We're going to run out of crops. We're going to run out of chemical inputs. We're going to have huge problems with the greenhouse gas emissions. We're going to have huge problems with the antimicrobial resistance, all of that. I'm saying it's entirely possible to get over this hump if we change the way it's made and get to a post-scarcity world. We can think in terms of abundance. We can think in terms of feeding sub-Saharan Africa, India, Southeast Asia, all these regions. So whether it's 1,500 calories, 2,500 calories, 50 grams of protein, 120 grams of protein, we can do it. And it's happening right now as we speak.
You feed sub-Saharan India, but who'll feed Canada? I'm worried about them because they're really going to suffer. They're in the middle of an election. Anybody can take over there. Trudeau's probably going to go down and things are going to change in the West. I'm worried the West is going to become more like us and we're going to become more like the West.
I'm afraid you're much more of an adept political commentator than I, so I stay out of these things normally.
All right, before we wind up, very quickly, you haven't mentioned, Varun, how you got into this. We have a vague idea of Ramya's nirvana, like, you know, sense towards sitting in that silly canteen and realizing she has to go heavenward. What about you?
So I grew up in Mumbai. My father's a cancer surgeon. Ooh. All right. So I thought about healthcare my entire life. I studied in the US for some definition of studied. Wasn't a very good student. But I got
involved. Where in the US?
I was in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania.
Pittsburgh. So he's come from money. Even with scholarship. I'm just putting it together. I would say roughly 100,000 for 2 or 3 years, US. So we're looking at all good here. But that's good.
I'm glad we're creating this profile of me. Yeah. So
my family's in Pittsburgh, my sister's entire family.
Oh, that's wonderful. You should let me know. I'll be there in December probably.
I don't want to visit them. They make me clean and all that. It's a different world altogether. Sunday he wants to fix the car, my brother-in-law. I'm like, who fixes a car? You know, we have people for that.
It's what all kind of, DIY there.
Yeah, it was a first world crap. I mean, they sound like the third world to me. You go there and do everything yourself. They gave me a hammer and told me to help with the window once.
Culture, man. Culture is very
complicated. I don't even shut a window. I go, Nirmala! I mean, isn't that the way it should be done? I'm sorry. You were saying.
So, yeah, I studied in the US, all right? And I got involved in analyzing these questions of what are the most important things we can do with our lives. And then when you analyze that question, this particular problem, which is industrial animal agriculture, comes up over and over and over again. So if you care about public health, as I did, if you care about food security, as I did, if you care about climate change, if you care about any of these things, it makes complete sense to try and target this problem.
But everybody cares for 2 minutes and then you get on with your life. The fact that you actually go and do something is the...
Yeah, and I think for the vast majority of people, we should take morality off the plate and just give them the option. But for me, this was a calling. It was to work with the Good Food Institute, set up the Good Food Institute India, and see how we can create this sector on the ground in India.
Okay, I think you're being a little immodest, both of you all, because obviously you are far more sensitive than people like me. But we need something like that, because otherwise the world will just turn on its head and die. But you haven't mentioned alcohol. I just want to know, where do we stand with alcohol? I understand that we need to stop with the meat and all that, but what about booze? Ramya, you first. You're a heavy drinker?
No.
Don't touch the stuff?
Don't drink anymore?
You're like me. I stopped because I started looking at other people's wives and, you know, then calling them up and all that. That became a little embarrassing.
This is really like therapy. It's actually feeling like therapy. I'm going
to... Man, you got to let it out, Ramya. You got to let it out. I believe so.
Bill you at the end.
Yes. Do you drink, Varun?
Yeah, once in a while.
He's a bloody drunkard. I'm telling you, Ramya, don't trust this guy. Be very careful. He's from Pittsburgh. They all drink heavily. That place is filled with drunkards.
Yeah, famous drunkard Andrew Carnegie.
There you go. Yeah.
That was a Pittsburgh insider
Fair
joke
enough.
For anyone.
One good joke for the day. No, they'll Google him. Don't worry. All right, that was Ramya and Varun, and we'll be back with the AMAs after I have a bite. Perhaps meat.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to another great week on the IVM Podcast Network. If you're not following us on social media, I really don't know what to tell you at this point in time. I mean, like, I'm so disappointed in you. Please go follow us. We're IVM Podcast on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. Also, got a quick survey running. It's a very short survey. It's a survey which helps brands understand what the effectiveness of podcast advertising is. We'd really appreciate your help if you could go there and help us out with that. It's on ivmpodcast.com/survey. Really would appreciate your help with that. So this week on Cyrus Says, Cyrus is joined by Ramya Ramamurthy and Varun Deshpande of the Good Food Institute. They explain what plant-based meat is, what will be the next food revolution, and the objective behind their podcast, Feeding 10 Billion. That's not all you're going to see of Ramya this week. Ramya is also on the Paperback Podcast with Rachita and Satyajit. She discusses her book Rebuild and points out how brands have tackled situation of crisis. Guys, we have some really exciting news this week too. Our show, Advertising is Dead, has reached 50 episodes. The special occasion was marked with a live recording at the Glitch office. We had some really, really great guests for this episode as well. Rohan Joshi, the comedian, was there, as was actor, social media influencer, and co-host of Agla Station Adulthood, Ritasha Rathore. The episode drops on Tuesday, November 5th. Make sure you check it out. On our Karnada podcast, Tale Harate, Pawan and Suryat sit down to talk about how Karnataka must think about its future so that the state can deliver prosperity and well-being to all its residents. On Simplified, the gang is back for part 4 of the 150th episode. That's a long 150th episode they got going there. Join Chuck and Naren as they break down the dying question of why is Sion called Shiv, the Easter Islands, Instagram influencer ecosystems, and a whole lot more. And with that, let's get you on with your show.
If you have any questions for Cyrus, write to us on Facebook, Twitter, or Instagram. Or you can send an email to whatcyrussays@gmail.com.
All right, well, they've fed or are going to feed 10 billion. I'm going to attempt to feed just 3. My standards are low.
That's
3, not billion, 3. Just three. One, two, three. Yeah. Ek, do, teen.
That's the, yeah, the appropriate number.
I'm like, I'm talking to 2-year-olds to explain one thing. Amit Doshi and Abbas have joined us. Abbas, yes, has come back from Goa.
Yes.
Quickly, the vacation of a lifetime. What happened exactly? How did you survive?
I think I chilled for
what
a good chill? 2 weeks.
What is chill?
I did nothing.
Indians chill anyway. We always look like we're in coma.
I walked on beaches. I attended a film festival. Where I met your wife, by the way, at Regal.
Again?
Yes. Not again. I mean, yes. Again, yeah, again in life, first time
wife,
at the festival.
My wife, who is a mommy, went for mommy. Yeah, that's right. That's right. She went. She liked actually most of the movies. I think only one she didn't like, but the Brad Pitt one she abused. Some Brad Pitt super one was, hit one.
Oh, the Ad Astra. Huh?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Mm. It was like a Hindi film from the 60s. It was just not making any sense.
Okay.
And that was a big headliner and all, which will soon be released on Netflix.
Okay.
Yeah. It just tells you that you can have a big star, it means nothing.
Also, I mean...
The other films that she saw were all like lesser-known independent indie films with low budgets and... People that you and I don't know.
Right, but then I think that also might have something to do with her taste, right? She has taste, we don't.
She's a leftist. She's a leftist. She's alone in this country. She has no friends. Yeah. No doubt about that. Except Abbas. Two leftists going to Regal to watch film about a farmer struggling with soil or something like that. Yeah. Without even Desh Ki Dharti playing in the background. But so quickly, Goa, you didn't tell us. So what do you do in Goa?
I was, like I said, I went to a lot of beaches, had certain food substances which aren't available in other states.
Animals which are banned.
Yeah.
Like pigeon. Yeah. Very bad. Don't eat pigeon. Huh?
Met some friends who stay in Goa. So, yeah.
Stay in Goa?
Yeah, who are from Goa.
Oh, okay, locals.
Yeah, locals.
And what is this walk on beaches? You sound like a teenage girl writing in a diary. I love going on walks on beaches and moonlight walks.
Walk on beach, sit hands. On the beach. What else do you do in Goa?
Yeah, that's why I think about it. We made such a big deal out of Goa, but at the end of the day, except for the drinking and eating and all that,
it's drinking.
What else is there to do? But walking on the beach and go to Chowpatty. What's the biggie?
There is no biggie.
You know what my boys used to do? Well, okay, all of us. I shouldn't say my boys. Is the foreigners would be the topless topless foreigners. I don't know if they're still there.
They're still there, right? But they're not as big a deal now as they used to be.
You know, so for our time, it was huge, no? So before the selfie, and my good friend Vikram Thadani, now worth 200 crores, his claim to fame is going to these two really atrociously unattractive women from Eastern Europe and taking a picture with them. They're both topless. And he takes a picture and then he shows it to all of us because we have those, what's that, Polaroid or whatever camera.
Right.
And shows it to all. Look how old we are. That's funnier than my story. Then come and show it to all of us. Yeah. And we thought we were like studs. I got topless women in my photo. Women who will never know your name, never see you again, never acknowledge you in public. And if you meet them in Europe, they'll spit on you. But for us, these were the cheap thrills, literally cheap thrills. Yeah. So Abbas, anything like that?
No.
All you can do is eat banned meat.
Yes.
That's all you can do.
It rained also 2 days while I was there.
But isn't that nice?
It was nice, yeah.
It becomes a little cool and it looks nice and greeny. It has a greeny feel to it, which people don't really associate Goa with. You only think of beaches.
Well, actually, no, I think that there is like two different Goas in that sense, right? There is the more kind of woody forest.
I like that. I like that more.
I enjoy that too, yeah. Yes. The beachy is like these days a little too.
And you have to speak Hebrew or Russian to understand people there, you know. It's just nonsense.
That is also.
Very tough. Yeah. Very tough. We've digressed too much. Yes. He's still happy coming back from the holiday and he's smiling. And are you sure you didn't take any substances? You just talk about the band.
Not that I remember.
Alrighty.
Not that I remember.
And just for a record, this is a very Indian thing. It was an all male holiday.
Uh-huh.
All male holiday to Goa is just a very Indian experience from the ages of 16
Dil
to 30.
Hai, dude.
Exactly. Yeah. And they made it into a movie. Yeah. Those guys could afford to go to Paris. And they did. No, they didn't.
Did they?
No,
one of them goes to
some. One of them
London
comes from London.
Australia, actually.
Australia. Yeah. Very good, Abbas. Very good.
Okay, the first one comes from Tarun Kaushik. He says, Cyrus, since you spoke about not glorifying terrorists and criminals, I'd like to know your views on Joaquin Phoenix's Joker. Do you think the debate on whether or not it should have been made with so much perfection makes sense?
Okay, didn't see it, but I've heard everybody complaining about the fact that it glorifies violence, whatever that means. I don't understand that because I come from the school of cinema that loves those kind of films from Scarface onwards. You know, you watch Rambo, I think Rambo 1, 93 people are killed. What else is there in the movie? How do you describe it? In four lines, bang bang, shoot shoot, kill kill.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I mean, like a movie like The Godfather glorifies violence like no other movie does, right? I mean,
there
like it turns it into this like kind of amazing royalistic kind of endeavor.
Yeah, it's voyeuristic happy.
So I mean, yeah. So I mean, like you know, that, and I don't think glorifying violence is the issue. The thing is, I haven't seen The Joker mostly because it doesn't appeal to me. The main character does not seem like you know. I don't really.
You don't want the villain to be the hero.
I don't
want
to watch.
You don't like the perspective.
Yeah, no, I don't want a 2-hour movie about a psychopath, right?
Yeah.
I mean, that's what The Joker is, right? right?
It's like going in the movie, you know he's a villain. At the end of the film, he's still a villain. So, like, what's the catch?
Yeah. And he's just not even like a villain, right? There are villains who are interesting.
Mm. Right.
He is the villain who is random and like this, right? So, I mean, I don't know. I've heard really good things about it.
And there's something they've sold a very wrong theme here. Mm. He's the Joker, but he's not funny. He just laughs like an idiot.
Well, that's
he's like that aunt of yours who's in her 90s.
He's
and
a failed comedian in the film.
Oh, God, that's too touchy. I can't see that film. I'll never see that film. That's too raw, man. That's too raw. And I'm waiting for the Marathi version, yeah. The Joker. That'll be more fun. What do you think? Yeah, but I like this. Everybody says glorifies violence, too much violence, both violence, both marpeet. And at the end of the day, they all go and see it. So, you know, there's a big connect between how we act, that we think is politically correct to say all these things, but we'll end up seeing it. So my point is, if it draws you and it's some sort of cinema that you like, just see it. Yeah. Why be complex,
no,
right?
So I think glorifying violence is silly, right? So like, you know, I mean, that's a dumb argument.
The statement,
right?
You mean?
Yeah, the argument that it's glorifying violence, so I don't want to say it, that's just a dumb argument. But like, even like, there was the other one, right? Suicide Squad.
Right.
Again, it was full of all the DC Universe villains.
Also, tough to say three times in a row.
Suicide Squad. So that was not a great movie, but I wanted to see it nonetheless because the characters that were in there were somewhat appealing. Will Smith playing
Deadshot.
Then Harley Quinn played by Margot Robbie.
Yeah, but you know, these are all sophisticated versions of the same thing. We grew up watching Amitabh Bachchan films, for example. What do we watch them for? Good over evil, lots of De Dhanadhan, bang bang, punch.
Yeah.
It's the same thing whether it was Sylvester Stallone or Bruce Willis or whichever culture. I now watch Korean gangster films. Mm. So it's the same thing. Yeah. For some reason, maybe it's a male thing, I don't know. We just love watching.
No, violence is where stakes come in, right? It's not the only place, but violence is one way where you can create real stakes in a story.
Yeah.
So I mean, like, given that,
and everybody doesn't have footage of Baghdadi being blowing himself up or whatever, you know. So you got, you know, where art imitates life or life imitates art. So I'm okay, but I want to watch this film. I think we should see this movie because lots of people say lots of things about it. Yeah. So one day we will see the Joker.
No, I will watch it. I don't really feel like making a theater excursion for it. At some point, I will watch it because I will feel like, you know what? I feel like torturing myself today. Let me torture myself today.
Yeah, but you know, it's a bit like the Ramayana with only Ravan and no Ram. Oh God, terrible metaphor.
Yeah.
But where's Batman? I mean, for someone who grew up with the DC comics and all, where's Batman? Joker, kai karto Joker. Sorry,
there was also the
I'm
Joker
not that
with...
fluent in Marathi, so you have to excuse me. Batman kote gela? Is that good?
Yeah, fine. Okay, this one comes from Kishan KY. He says, "Hi Cyrus, Amit and Abbas. I am Kishan Kaluria, originally from Coorg, Karnataka, currently living in New York City.
Carrying a gun. License to kill. Coorgi.
I am aware that Cyrus is an animal lover and a strict non-vegetarian. Oh, I would love to get some of your views on animal cruelty in the meat industry around the world.
Wow. Also, what do you... appropriate episode for this question.
Man, this guy is like, this is like meet your in-laws. You know, I'm going to ask you questions that are so awkward and painful.
What do you think about animal sacrifices for religious ceremonies?
Yeah, okay. You know the answers to all that, the correct answers, so I don't even want to get into it. But you've pinned me down with this one. I want to go back to Joker. I'm feeling a psychopathic tendency in my blood. It's boiling inside me for a second. Yeah, this is a tough one. I have to wear this on my neck until the day I actually become vegetarian. There's nothing you can have it both ways. That's all there is to it. And God, don't want to get into all the animal cruelty. I'll put it this way. There was this story once, I remember, because I worked with dog associations and animal associations from time to time, of a German shepherd being stabbed and left in a dustbin in car. You know, this kind of story, and it's just very, very painful. But you have to keep in mind what people do to human beings to understand that what they'll do to animals will be even worse,
right?
Because what people do to their own children or their neighbor's children or, you know, somebody's relative or blah blah, you know, I mean, the cruelty that we have exhibited as human beings is just phenomenal, if that's the right word. It's just beyond, because no animal can do that. They just cannot. They can kill for whatever reason, to protect territory or their mate or food. But by and large, they cannot do this kind of genocidal behavior or very evil, manipulative, painful, and to go out of your way and clinically kill someone and hurt someone, which is only from us. So,
Please
expect the worst. That's what I say. Expect the worst. And don't blame the Joker. Kai bolto? Joker is also a part of the family of humans. Abbas, if you're not happy with my Marathi, put your hand up.
Yeah, as someone who speaks very little Marathi, I have no right to criticize someone else's
Why
Marathi.
The hell? We should speak. We should practice.
We should learn Marathi.
Chalo.
Bottom line, next. You can be an animal lover and still eat meat and it's nothing.
No, you can't. It's a bit difficult. Yeah. That's it. We're running out of time. Yes. These guys are the 10 billion feeding thing. They kept their mouths open for so long. We have no, nothing left for AMA in terms of time. Anyway, we'll see everybody soon. It's bye-bye from all of us. And Amit, let's go to the loo. Follow me at Instagram and Twitter on Bored Brocha. I'm so bored, I need your help. I need your love. I need your touch. Okay, just follow me. Okay, catch us on any of the podcasting apps, please. We beg you, we need you. Send us your questions on Twitter on Cyrus Says In. Or you can email us, even if you're not female, on whatcyrussays@gmail.com.
And that's what Cyrus says.
How many times have you caught yourself Googling stuff on health and wondering if it's the right information? How many times have you heard different health experts give opposing views, which has only left you confused? There are rising cases of cancer, heart, diabetes, stress, and autoimmune diseases. Meet the patients and the experts who paved the path of true healing. Join me, Rachna Chachi, cancer nutrition coach and nutritional therapist on Heal and Hearty. I take you through my own journey of recovery from an incurable disease and the journey of so many others who healed only via nutrition and holistic healing. Find the answers you seek for what's good for your health and what's good for your soul. You can listen to us on the IVM Podcast app or ivmpodcast.com. Don't forget your date with good health.
Janice, what do you think couples did before TV was invented?
I don't know, go for walks on the beach, long drives, fancy dinners, have more sex maybe?
But what did we do when we decided to move in together? We debated between the Chromecast and the Fire Stick.
We gave up on sleeping early so we could stay up watching true crime shows.
We got ourselves 3 cat babies.
And basically became the cutest couch potatoes around.
Okay then.
In case you guys still haven't got it, we are a TV crazy, Netflix loving, binge watching Mr. and Mrs.
I'm Anirudh Guha.
I'm Janice Iquera.
And if like us, you snort TV for breakfast, lunch and dinner, this is the podcast for you.
Tune in every Thursday on the IVM Podcast app or wherever it is that you get your podcast from. This is
Mr.
and Mrs.
Binge Watch.